You guys tell me how the microphone sounds in this video, if it needs to go up or down, or if there's any background noise or annoying things, and how does my voice sound. In the past, I explained in this video in detail how to use the E3 function in the Nikon D850. Basically, if you set it up to background only, any adjustment, bias adjustment you make for the exposure affects only the background. That's a flash function, provided that you're using flash. And you watch this video and it explains it in detail how to use it. The result is that if you have something like that and you're using flash and you have the option activated, when you bias the exposure minus 2 stops or 3 stops, you end up with something like that straight from the camera. So you don't need Photoshop, you don't need anything. To me, this option is particularly useful because most of my shots are during the middle of the day. I do not have the luxury of golden hours, so I have to deal with very harsh highlights. In this exposure, which is straight out of the camera, this is the RAW file. As you can see, I biased the exposure 2/3 of a stop down, and with the option E3 activated, it only affects the background. So my subject is properly exposed from the flash. The background is a little lower, so I can deal with highlights and all that stuff. And the image is perfect as it is, straight off the camera to be sent to the lab for prints. So now the question is from a viewer: if my camera does not have the E3 function, how do I do it so that I can darken or lighten the background, only the background, leaving the subject unaffected when I use flash? I will show this method here, but also keep in mind that if the background is not really further away from the subject, it's not really background. So that's the first hint at the solution. So whatever setting you have here, E3 or not, the exposure is going to be the same. So this is the model, this is the background. Background is something that has to be further away, because if it's in the same distance from the camera, well, it's not much of a background anymore. The E3 option, if you have the D850, you can choose background only, but let's choose entire frame, which is what all the other cameras have. They're by default locked their entire frame. And I have the flash on. Now, look at my speed, 250, aperture F4, ISO locked at 64. The ISO cannot go up to compensate. So with the flash on, I take a picture like this, and obviously we have the model and the background pretty much evenly lit. Okay, now I want the image to be darker. What am I gonna do? Increase the speed. Look at the speed. Let's say 1/2000 of a second. 1/2000 of a second. With the same ISO, base ISO, started to get darker. There is some flash over there. That's why outdoors this works better, because there is some flash still, because it's reflecting all over the room. But it is darker. Let's increase the speed even more. 1/4000 of a second. You see that? 1/4000 of a second. Because I want a really dark picture. Well, the picture is dark except the model. It's only the background darkened. Only the background darkened except the model. Look at the model. She still has enough light. Why? Because she's closer. She's closer to the flash. That's why. So how do you photograph a flower outdoors and darken the background? Make sure that it's closer. than the background and increase the shutter speed so that not much light comes in. If it's closer, the flash will flash it enough. At 2,000th of a second, the flash doesn't have, or 4,000th of a second as I used here, the flash doesn't have that much power at this speed to flash the background as well. The background is further away, it's going to be darker. Okay, and you can go even to, let's say, 8,000th of a second, you see here, and take the picture with the flash and look how dark the background is now. Oops, continuously press the wrong buttons. But you still have a little bit of light to work with, right? So basically, if you keep the ISO steady, all the rest is just a play of how much light you're going to allow to the sensor by playing with the speed or the aperture. And the flash, you have it just to flash something that's close, like a fill-in thing, right? So there is no mystery to this technique. The E3 option is nothing more than a shortcut to the things that you can do manually. So now we're going to go to a different technique. Let's say you don't want to raise the shutter speed to 8,000 or something, but you want to keep it to something more reasonable, like 1600. Now keep in mind that whatever I show here is more effective outdoors, because here in the closed room you also have the reflections of the flash from all of the walls. Now, if you take a picture at 1600 f4 ISO 64, we're getting this, right? And we want the background darker. So here's what I'm gonna do. I'm gonna go in my flash and I'm gonna select zoom, and I'm gonna zoom in the flash head to, let's say, 120, which will concentrate the flash light in a narrower area. And I take the picture, and this is what happened. Okay, I did too much here, right? 120 millimeters zoom. And as you can see, it flashed the subject more. Well, I can go even more with this flash. What does it show now? It goes to 135 with this lens, and take the picture at an even higher speed. Let's say 4,000th of a second. And again, I darkened the background. Well, most of it. Okay, so generally, and if the subject was not in the center, I can always, you know, turn the head of the flash around to point it at the subject or wherever I want. So the sky's the limit with what you can do when you lock down the ISO so it doesn't compensate, and you play in manual. Sorry about this up and down in volume. At any rate, the reason that the flash did not zoom all the way up to 200 millimeters is because I'm using a DX lens. By mistake, I put a DX zoom on the camera. And also, do not forget, as I said before, this is also straight out of the camera. You see, this is the RAW file, NEF RAW file. And I have also used 2/3 of a stop down in bias, which is applied to the background. Why is it applied to the background? Well, because the background is not lit by the flash, so it's darker because of the bias, but the foreground, the subject, is closer to the flash, so it's going to get more light. There's no magic to it, right? Close to the flash, further away from the flash. This part though here, you see this little guy over here? This is not background. It's not background. It's pretty much in the same distance from the flash. So it's going to be lit very well. So background is things that are further away from the flash. They're not going to get that much flash power thrown on them. And they're going to be as dark as you want, depending on the bias or the speed that you choose. So there is no mystery to it. You can do that with any camera. The light in the background depends on the sun. So if I increase the shutter speed, it will be darker. The light on her face depends on the flash, because she's close to the flash. And since I'm using TTL, the camera will ensure that the exposure on the face is the correct one. I'm going to close with David Ellingsworth, who says that he has the green tint problem in portrait pictures out in nature. And I have been saying that for 3 years now, since this picture. Maybe 4 years, because this is from 2018, where you get a little bit of a greenish tint, and that's just a little bit here. From the reflections from the environment. So what you want less light from the environment, right? You want a stronger light on the subject, a stronger neutral light. Because when you have a strong neutral light on the subject, and here it could have been even stronger versus the environment if I had used a higher shutter speed. It was my mistake that I used 1/160th of a second. I should have used 1/500th of a second. But generally speaking, when most of the influence is from a neutral artificial light, well, then of course you can very easily correct things, right? So within, how much did it take me? 4 seconds? And now you have before and after with these two sliders that I'm talking about, and the after one is ready to be printed. Just take it to a lab as it is. So basically, what you want here, this is the RAW file, as you can see. ISO 64, aperture 5.6. Is a light strong enough on the subject that will give the same luminance visual effect on the face almost as the background, right? And that's a lot of light. To achieve this much light with a continuous light, the LED panel would have to be so bright that it would blind the model. It would be like looking at the sun through thin clouds. You can look at it, but not more than a second. And still, even the modern LEDs with decent colors, like the Rotolite, the Let Go, these kind of brands, you have to operate them in flash mode for photography. In flash mode, not in continuous light mode. So you'll still be like carrying a flash, but it will be 10 times bigger. I had panels in the past. I had the Let Go 600, which for its time was one of the best. It still sold in the used market because it was good for $200, $250 to this day, used. It had excellent color and everything, but outdoors at maximum power, it was like half of the SP500 Nikon flash. That's the SP500, the little guy. If you find it used, go grab it. So to tell me that you used a small LED panel light for an event, it's hard to believe, unless you were shooting 10,000 ISO, the whole event. You know, because it cannot light anything, especially in an event. But I'm gonna go now to your last phrase, lessons we can learn from Vivian Meyer. I would say also more people here, like lessons we learn from Sebastio Salgado, whom I consider the most important reportage photographer of our times. But I'm going to give you a different perspective now on the whole subject. Because when you're funded by the government or a media organization, all your basic expenses paid, to travel to an interesting destination, or many, with your only job being compose and shoot, because the development and the print and the contrast of the pictures and the light and all that and all the aesthetics of the photograph will be taken care by other professionals back home when you send the rolls, and be considered a success if 1 out of 4 of the pictures you take is good enough for publication, using the most easy medium in the art, which is the black and white film, the most tolerant and easier thing to shoot, black and white film. I like the pictures. I love them. Some of them, I deeply admire them. But don't make gods out of them, because they had nothing else to do all day, and they were funded completely, fully, all their expenses by the government or media organizations. I had read way in the past an interview by Bresson, or was it a part of an interview somewhere, that down in Athens he was going in this cafe for 3 days in a row, waiting for something to happen, just sitting there, in a typical South European manner. The vast majority of people do not have this luxury of time. Now, here on YouTube there are plenty of people who are trust fund kids in photography, and you can tell by their lifestyle and by the fact that they don't do anything as a job. They're landowners or trust fund kids, or they have inheritances from their parents or life insurance or whatever. They don't have anything to do, and they still cannot produce good photographs, because the number one priority in their minds is to make the video on YouTube, not to actually do the art. And the thing is that almost all amateurs and beginners and hobbyists do not really shoot black and white film, which, as I said, is the most easy thing to shoot, the most tolerant. You can overexpose 3 stops and it can still be developed just fine. So we resort to color photography, which is the most difficult type of photography. And we all know that even if an image looks great in black and white because of the elements in the composition and the contrast, it may look horrible even if the colors are correct, because the colors are not the correct analogy, let's say, the correct proportion to each other, right? You can easily become a professional in black and white reportage photography because of the tolerance of the medium. The only thing that you need is good taste in composition. In color photography, though, if you want to be really good, you also need to consider the ratio of the colors. And you have to also consider that in color, greatly underexposed skin tones do not look good. In black and white, they pass, but not in color. So you need to know how to use flash, strobes in general, and diffusers and this and that, to be at least in the amateur level. Okay, in the decent amateur level. Now, you're mentioning film. Back in the days of film, I do not remember any camera kit being sold without a flash. Everybody thought, as a matter of fact, that it was mandatory, because the indoors photos were all completely black, no exposure at all. And the outdoors pictures without a flash looked terrible. Harsh shadows, it was like black and white, strong black and white. You needed something to fill in the shadows. So everybody had a flash on the camera. An uncle of mine in Athens did not know that you can actually remove the flash from the camera. So he always had it on there. At any rate, if you are trying to take portraits, not landscapes, portraits, with film, outdoors, without a flash, it's a futile attempt. You're always going to be wrong. And if you scan the negative with the intention of editing it, you basically have in your hands a gigantic JPEG. Even if you scan it as a gigantic TIFF file, it's already baked. The white balance is baked, the tint is baked, all the colors are baked. It's not like a RAW file. It's just a scan of an already developed, baked image. Now, there are many people on YouTube loading things in Photoshop and doing this and doing that. Yeah, do that. Do the same steps they do. Print out the image and tell me what came out. The print does not look good, right? And if you tilt it a little bit on the side, it looks like it has cello tape everywhere that you have applied a correction. Looks awful. And of course, in the compressed space of YouTube, they look good, especially if the model is attractive. But that's not the reality. They're selling lifestyles, they're selling the video itself. And as I said, most of these people are selling a lifestyle. Oh, look, I'm cool and hip and young and this and that, and I do this and I do that. That's just a gigantic pool of bullshit out there. Like the other guy who's shooting a landscape for focus stacking, and he takes the pictures at F11 to stack them up. Now, some of these channels also show prints once in a while. Have you noticed that these prints are kind of dead? The color in the prints is kind of dead. It's not popping out. It's not alive. Do you know why? Because just as in this picture, which is obviously overexposed, they say I'm gonna expose to the right, and then I'm going to reduce exposure and the highlights and this and that, right? So right here we have overexposed grass, but it's alive nevertheless. So the guy goes, oh, I'm gonna do this, and then I'm gonna do this. So now we have dead grass. The color is dead. All right? Yeah, it was overexposed. I was going for the bird with manual focus, so I didn't care about the exposure. But we have alive, dead. That's what they do. And if you do it in the entire image, it's particularly ugly on the print, because the print is not backlit like the monitor. It looks awful. Another snapshot from that day. That day I didn't take any good pictures. But this is a yellow that is starting to die, and you reduce the highlights and now it's completely dead. It's even a different color, because all these sliders, what they do, they change colors. That's what they do. So normally, actually, this will want something like that to make the yellow more live, more alive. Instead of doing the opposite thing before they print, what do? They reduce the highlights to the maximum. They do this, they do that. They kill the life out of the colors. And when it prints and it's not backlit, it's even worse. See, my daughter took this one. And it looks really lively, very alive. But it does have some highlights that are rather problematic. Now, if you play with it just a little bit, all right, it still looks good. This part, you can never get rid of it. Unless, I'm not going to go to graduated brushes and bullshit like that. It's going to look awful on the print. It's going to look like the sellotape effect, as I told you. But you cannot correct it more than that without it start looking like CGI. Because your brain is not stupid. And your brain is saying to itself, there is no chance in hell that the sun is hitting these flowers and they look like that. No way. When the sun is hitting the flowers, they never look like that. They look more, let's say, like that, best case scenario. So what do you do in such a case? You cannot do anything. I prefer not to do anything. I prefer to say, next time that I'm there, I'm going to be holding a large diffusion umbrella and have my daughter take the picture again. Try again. Because this part over here is not fixable. And if you try to fix it, as I say, yeah, you can start doing bullshit like that. The whole thing looks fake. All right, the whole thing looks fake. Because this is not a scene that you will ever see in real life like this. I mean, people are going to say, are you sure there was sun? Because that's not how nature looks when the sun is hitting it. This may appear more easily fixable. My daughter took this as well. And as it is right now, it looks realistic. It also doesn't look very good photographically, but it looks realistic. In the sense that it's a very strong sun hitting it. And if you start playing with the exposure, you see the orange starts to die. It's not the same color anymore, and it looks very anemic. And it starts looking unrealistic, as a matter of fact. Okay, so let's say you stay very conservatively over here, and then let's say you play with the highlights just a little bit before it starts looking completely unrealistic, like it's CGI or something. And you didn't really do much, right? At some point, my point is that, because even if you play with a color mixer, let's say, over here, and you go to the oranges, try to reduce the luminance, look at how it turns. It looks like shit, right? So at some point, you have to accept that the next time you go again with a diffusion umbrella or you wait for the clouds, you have to understand that the scene has limitations under strong sun, and that the more you process, the more unrealistic it may become, and you'll never find something that you really like. So you have to get it good in the camera, as good as possible. Perfect if possible. Now, a big diffusion umbrella would have done the trick here, and I have one. I just didn't take it with me. We're just casually going out to take pictures of the neighborhood flowers. But this was middle of the day, the sun hitting it directly. Don't expect that much from it. And don't expect that you're going to solve these problems with Photoshop. Especially, look at this leaf over here. Right now it looks fine, right? This part. And now it looks CGI-ish. Computer-generated image. It even lost half of its tonalities. Looks terrible and unrealistic. You see, the reason that people say I like film and this and that, and I consider the D500 to be closer to film, the film feel, than any other Nikon camera, is that film kind of restricts you. So there are flaws in the image, but you have to accept them as they are shot. And the film image does not contain your stupid Photoshop attempts. So the brain does not see anything that's completely stupid. So the whole image feels a little better. Because many times the brain sees things that are unrealistic, stupid, overprocessed, but you don't realize it yourself. It's just that the brain is telling you something in the background. So this is straight out of camera and looks good. It doesn't look perfect, but it looks good if I print it. Now, reduce the highlights. Oh, the grass is dead all of a sudden. Look at the grass. It's like dying. Now it's alive. Maybe I can play all the way up to here. Not more. Screw the histogram. What matters is how the image looks and feels. Okay, and that's why people like film. Because it limits them, they have to accept what they see, and it doesn't really have that many flaws. Because the minute people start to play with Photoshop and stuff, they're adding flaws in the picture. I'm still not entirely convinced that Photoshop is a photography tool. It's more like a graphic design tool. Camera Raw is more like a photography tool in a way. But you have to take it easy, because you start doing things like that, the whole image starts looking more unrealistic, edited, processed, whatever. You know, now this image doesn't even look like it's hit by the sun, because this is a midday sun. This is middle of the day. It should look a little overexposed. That's what the brain expects to see. And if the brain sees things like that, it's going to say, what the hell is this? I never seen nature like that in the middle of the day with direct sun hitting it. In other words, you took a picture like that, this picture is totaled. Just like a car after a bad accident is totaled beyond repair, this is a picture that's totaled. Go after a few days again and get the picture again with the correct exposure. Photography is a hobby for patient people. Okay, don't just go on YouTube and find some guy who sells videos. He sells videos on YouTube. and pull down 45 different layers and make it faker and faker with every layer that you pull down. Well, in the case of this flower, actually, even if you get the exposure right, the flower itself is kind of dead. Look at all this. And this is what happens, and we have the worst botanic gardens in history here in Chicago, because they started a woke hiring program a few years ago, and ever since, we do not have good flowers. You go to botanic gardens in Michigan, and you have all these exotic masterpieces, and then you come here to Chicago, and it looks like an ordinary grandmother's garden, where 99% of the flowers are in horrible condition. In the previous video, I showed you this picture and how it looks printed in real life. Totally 3D, right? That's because the colors are alive. They got enough light on them. Get a flash and quit that software, blah, blah, this and that. Because it's getting you into a really bad rabbit hole from which you will never come out without having lost tons of time and probably tons of money as well. Why do you think professionals are carrying out all those strobes? Usually they fill out a small truck with strobes and soft boxes and this and that. Can't they just use software? Well, they know that the result out of software is total crap. That's why they're carrying all those lights. Really powerful lights, too. And you never wondered, how come this straight out of camera guy gets it really straight out of camera so many times, and the other guy has to slave with 30 different layers and adjustments, this and that in Photoshop, and still his result is not good enough. Not good enough for a print. And even if he prints it, the result is kind of, I don't know, fake and without tone, without life. And let's go to the final comment by Milorad, who wants a video about flash comparisons. In this video over here, which is called Salad, somewhere in the middle, I had a detailed test of four Nikon speed lights in fixed and mixed white balance, like with environment light from behind, with this, with that, and then a detailed comparison up close of the white balance. And this channel now is an absolute mess, because this little part, all by itself, could actually be a video on its own. And it has so much useful information for the users. And I buried it in a video called Salad that probably nobody's gonna watch. And this video, as a matter of fact, is not exactly what you would call a salad, but pretty useful in techniques, in measurements, in this and that. And in this video, I have small modifiers, test of small modifiers. So if you go to my playlist that's called Flash and Light Modifiers, you will find a lot of stuff that I myself forgot I put there. But the old Ken Rockwell was very good in cataloging things. Nice tables. So we're going to use this one. So I'm going to start with the SP400. I have made videos about this flash. Very convenient. Excellent light quality for its size and everything. Quite flexible. You can still tilt the head up and bounce the light if you want. The only problem is that it cannot synchronize above 250 shutter speed. So if you're trying to increase your shutter speed and you cannot, the camera won't let you do it. It's not because your camera is broken, it's because you have connected this flash. So it's not really a good option outdoors. But it's a great option indoors, because it's small, convenient, and this and that. The SP500 is Nikon's smartest flash ever. It synchronizes all the speeds, up to 8000. Of course, above 2000 doesn't have that much power anymore. But you're never going to see banding or cut off parts of the image or things like that all the way up to 8000 speed. You're just going to see a reduced power. Well, hell, at 8000, not even the sun goes through sometimes, right? So it's great for indoors and outdoors. Very smart flash. and very powerful for the average users. And now this part over here. SP700, great flash. You see the power over here. The SP800, very powerful flash, a little cryptic. You have to press and hold the back buttons for the menus to appear. So it's kind of like a learning curve as far as the settings are concerned. Of course, you can skip all the settings and just connect it on the camera TTL and it's just going to work. The white balance is a tiny little bit on the bluish side, so you may need to correct a few images there. Very easily correctable, by the way. The SP900, the most powerful flash Nikon ever produced, but they didn't ensure a good cooling of the flashing head. So you're not gonna use this flash pop, 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 pop. You're gonna wait a little bit to cool down, or it's going to burn. And that is why they issued the SP910 afterwards. You can see the difference in power. The SP900 is 40, the SP910, 34. Color-wise and quality-wise, it's the same thing, except that the SP910 does not really overheat that much, so you can work it like duck, 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 and you'll be fine. The SP5000, if you're not planning of using the WRR10 remote controller, then you're gonna always think that you overpaid, because a lot of its price is that it's radio controlled for the WRR10, in which case when you use it, it's a great flash, and probably the best in color of all Nikon's flashes. Very, very tiny difference, of course. But in your case, I would probably go get the SP910 or even the SP900 if you find one in mint condition with the intention not to use it with continuous shooting. The SP5000 was one of the reasons actually I left the Z system, because the remote on the Z cameras connects on the side, which means I'm going to break it. You see? That's going to break. Within 5 minutes, I will have broken it. The D850 connects it on the front and upwards, so no problem. This is how it connects on the DSLRs. And one would say the Z9 also has a front connector, which means that the Z8 will probably also have a front connector. The advantage of this system is that I can control this system as many flashes. In different groups and this and that, as I show in this video, detailed instructions on how to control two flashes here. And you can control about, I think, 8 flashes for each group. And you set them up here, TTL or manual or this or that, and the compensation in thirds of a stop for each group. And all that from the back screen of the camera, which means if I have the camera up high, I can tilt the screen of the camera and see what I'm doing. Even if the camera is 2 meters high. I cannot do that with the clumsy controllers that you put on the hot shoe. And here's other advantages. With the Nikon solution, I only carry 3 things. Well, the WRR10 I don't even have to carry because it's screwed on the camera. Out of sight, out of mind. The flash and the camera, that's it. With the third party, I have to carry little things, little devices. And each one has its own battery. Sometimes proprietary battery. Or little pill batteries that you cannot find easily. And then there is another big elephant in the room, the firmware. Because you buy the third-party system for whatever reason. Maybe it has a little more reach. Instead of 50 feet or whatever is the Nikon system, it's going to give you, I don't know, 200 feet or something. And then you buy another Nikon camera and it doesn't work. So you wait for the manufacturer of the other flash system to update their firmware so that it works, if the other manufacturer is still in business. And usually it doesn't tilt. You put it up on the hot shoe of the camera, and if the camera is up high and you want to change the settings, you have to lower the camera. With an Icon system, I don't have to lower the camera, I just tilt the back screen of the camera and I make my adjustments there. So now my impressions from this website, and this guy sells $3,000 workshops. This first image is my most favorite of his collection. Although it's a long exposure, it looks very realistic, very dramatic. Why? Because it does not look processed. Now, my printer would tell me, well, there's a little much cyan over here, it makes the rock look blue, but that's very easily corrected. This one is okay, but he has overprocessed the sun rays, and it looks kind of fakey, and I would have preferred them to be more diffused, like they are in real life. This one is fine. This one also has this overprocessing the sun rays. What I like about it most is that the clouds in the background are hardly visible, which makes them very dramatic. I love this, very mysterious. This part I don't like because of the color. There is no such color in the sea. This one is my least favorite. As a matter of fact, I don't like it at all. There is so much blue in the sky and it looks a fake blue, as a matter of fact. You never see this color in the sky. And also there is so much detail on the mountain because he suppressed all the highlights. Now here's the problem. If you actually stand there in real life, you cannot see that much detail because there is a strong sun on the snow, hitting the snow. The sun is very strong. And here he suppressed the highlights so much that the colors start to feel a little bit on the weak side, weak colors on the mountain. It's as if somebody is dimming down the sun, right? So it doesn't really look realistic. You need more light over here and less detail to look realistic, and definitely not this ridiculous blue in the sky. So I don't like this at all. This one I like, beautiful image, with the exception of the clouds in the center. They look processed. You see, there are no clouds like this over here in the center. This one I like very much because of the subject, the composition. The scene is very dynamic, how he placed the trees over here. It has only one problem that is very easily fixable. It is oversaturated. As a result, the green over here looks as if somebody painted it with flashy green color, and there is a lot of red going on over here. So you reduce a little bit the saturation, it's going to be a masterpiece, this image. Beautiful picture. This one is okay, a little too mauve in this area, but other than that it's okay, good composition. This one, again, he suppressed the highlights so much that the waves look like snow, and they look like they're still, they're not moving, because they look like snow, and snow is not moving. By suppressing the highlights so much, he deprived the scene of motion. See? Watch it a little bit and you'll understand what I say. Because you probably have been, I have seen this scene raised in the island of Crete, right? 1,000 times in my life. And these should be more white, some of it even blown, and the motion will be there. But if you turn them like snow, it looks like there's no motion. Maybe also very high shutter speed. This is beautiful. I love this. This is one of the most realistic scenes because it doesn't look processed. So there is a great sense of depth and realism. But my most favorite is this one, the first one. Because it looks like it's not processed at all. Very dramatic, very nice. Oh, by the way, this is my almost permanent kit right now when I go out with my daughter for pictures and stuff, the Joe McNally on the SP5000. But instead of a Z camera, imagine the D850 here. And nobody gives a shit about the size of your camera, even if you lie down on the floor completely and take a picture like this, which turned out to be the worst picture of that day. It's kind of like a Mickey Mouse thing, but I also use the flash, and flash from below, from underneath of the face, is not attractive at all. But I like the rest of the images from this 10-minute trip at the mall. Middle of the day sun, which is my usual time for pictures. They turn out good. Anyway, thanks a lot. Bye.